This is going to be the last video lecture for Unit 8. And Unit 8, we've been talking about scaffolds, but now I want to spend a few minutes talking about powered aerial work platforms or aerial lifts. Usually, you know, in the field, we just refer to them as man lifts, but the more correct technical name is powered aerial work platform. It's like a scaffold to a large degree, but it's powered. It'll power up, power down. You can work at different levels. You can move from point A to point B under power. Wonderful tools. And it's not just construction. Usually we think of construction, we think of man lifts or aerial lifts, but it's not just construction. Most general industry operations will have man lifts on site. There are two types of man lifts that we'll talk about. And then a third variation that's not really designed as a man lift, but is sometimes used as a man lift. I could probably spend an entire class just talking about aerial lifts, especially if we were a face-to-face class and could do some hands-on activities with aerial lifts. But it, like I said earlier in the unit, we're running short on time. I just want to give you guys an overview of aerial lift safety, mostly for you ladies who don't have any experience with aerial lifts, because I want to make sure you leave this class with a basic knowledge of aerial lifts and aerial lift safety. Again, I will refer to some OSHA regulations, but we're not going to go regulation by regulation, looking at those regulations that apply to aerial lifts. And there's really not a lot in the OSHA manual, actually. OSHA refers to other resources, as you'll see once we get into it. Now, there are a lot of resources available on aerial lift safety. On Blackboard, I've provided to you several of these resources. Here is the cover for one of the resources right here. This is a document that talks about best practices when we are training aerial work platform operators when we're training operators of this equipment. Operators need the training, but also workers who are working around this equipment need training also. When it comes to resources that are available to you, if anybody's interested, I have over 3,000 files. I think there's like 3,200 files like this, documents like this, that I regularly share with students in the program. All you have to do, if you would like to have these files that you might use in your future career as a safety professional, just bring me a flash drive. Another thing to think about, if you take the OSHA 30 next May, that's when we're planning on doing an OSHA 30 for construction. If you take that class next May, everyone who takes that class, I give you a flash drive with all of these materials. And these are materials that I've accumulated over a 20-year career. Most of it is OSHA, NIOSH material. OSHA produces some wonderful training materials, guidebooks, and so on. And there's also in among these 3,000 files are a lot of the stuff I've created. Safety newsletter, PowerPoints that I've created for the OSHA 10 and the OSHA 30. Just a whole wealth of information that you could use in your career if you end up working as a safety professional. But let's go ahead and talk about aerial lifts. If you're interested, let me know. But let's go ahead and talk about aerial lifts. This is one of the more common types of aerial lifts, referred to as a boom lift. There are different varieties of boom lifts. There are boom lifts that only go 30, 40 feet up in the air. There are boom lifts that go hundreds of feet up in the air. There are boom lifts with stabilizers that make them less likely to tip over. There are boom lifts that have straight booms like we have here. Then we have boom lifts with articulating booms. The articulating boom, like we see in this picture here, allows the operator to position the basket more precisely than he or she would be able to position the basket with a straight boom. The articulating boom lifts are more flexible. Now, they're not going to go as high as the straight boom lifts, but they do allow operators to get into some tight corners with their basket. But this is what we mean by boom lift, one of the more common types of aerial lifts. The other of the two most common, the other type of aerial lift is the scissor lift. Scissor lifts don't generally go as high as boom lifts, and they should not go as high because they're not nearly as stable. As we'll see when we get into this, scissor lifts are much more prone to tip over than boom lifts because they have a narrow, very narrow footprint, very narrow, very small wheelbase, which makes them more unstable. Back to boom lifts for just a second. Boom lifts can be designed to work in rough terrain scenarios, rough terrain environments. Scissor lifts, they're pretty much limited to flat, solid surfaces. You know, there are scissor lifts that might have more of a rough terrain quality to them, but you really don't want to be using a scissor lift on a rough terrain in a rough terrain environment because of their tendency to turn over. Now, you can get scissor lifts, and here's one right here, that have extendable stabilizer arms. You extend these stabilizers on the front and the back, which you can't see the back on the big one here, but you extend these stabilizers, that makes it a lot less likely to tip over. If you need to go high, if you need to work in terrain that's not perfectly flat and solid, you need the models that have the extendable stabilizers or outriggers. Genie is one of the more popular manufacturers of scissor lifts, and we have three models of Genie scissor lifts here, ranging from a scissor lift on the small side up to one on the larger side. JLG, another manufacturer of scissor lifts and boom lifts and other equipment as well. See, what else can I say right now about scissor lifts? I don't like them. I'll say that, because of their propensity to tip over. And again, I'll talk more about that as we go along. Now, if you're in an environment where you're only operating on concrete floors and you're only going up 15 feet to change a light bulb, cool. But if that's not the environment, I would rather have a boom lift most of the time, because they're going to offer more stability. But there are areas where you can't get a boom lift, because they tend to have larger footprints. It's hard to get them into tight spaces, where a scissor lift like this, you could get into a tighter space. The third option that you will, that's not uncommon at all, a forklift or a telehandler is not a man lift. But you will see some companies that will put man baskets on the forks of a telehandler. This is a telehandler. A telehandler is a telescopic boom forklift, commonly referred to as a Skytrak. Even though Skytrak is a brand, Skytrak is a generic term that a lot of people use for all telehandlers. But a telehandler, the technical term, or the more correct term for this type of equipment, is a telescopic boom forklift, or a telehandler. And again, like I said, a lot of companies will put baskets on the forks, which is not illegal. It's not, it can be done correctly. It can be done safely. But for me, it's not the best practice. If you need to put men in a basket and elevate that basket, I think your best option is going to be a boom lift in most instances. Environment with smooth surfaces, solid floors, a solid surface, scissor lifts. Telehandlers aren't designed primarily as man lifts. That's one of the reasons they're not as good. They're not as safe. A lot of manufacturers of forklifts and telehandlers will not allow their equipment to be used as a man lift with a man basket. If you work for a company that's doing this, you need to make sure, first of all, that the manufacturer of the equipment allows the use of a man basket with their equipment, because there are many that don't, for liability reasons. If the manufacturer of the machine does allow the use of man baskets on the forks, it needs to be what I call an engineered basket. It should not be a job-built basket. A job-built basket is one that, the welder puts together at the last minute, or the carpenters put together at the last minute. This here is a classic example of a job-built basket that is not engineered. And as we will see here in a few minutes, two men died in an accident involving this piece of equipment. This is an engineered basket. This is an engineered basket. As long as the manufacturer approves of the usage of the basket with their machine, they're good to go. This, though, does look suspect. They have the basket sitting on top of a forklift pallet. That's not how it's supposed to work. The forks of the forklift should be inserted into these pockets. Right, there's a pocket there and a pocket there. The forks of the forklift should be inserted in those pockets. It shouldn't be sitting on top of a pallet like this. What they're doing, they're sitting it on top of the pallet. They're inserting the forks into the pallet. This basket is not securely attached to the machine. This basket, the way they've got it set up here, could easily fall off. And that's one of the requirements. If you use a man basket with a telehandler or forklift, the basket must securely attach to the fork or the carriage assembly. And the carriage assembly on this forklift here, it's right back there. It's the mechanism that allows the forks to go up and down. That's the carriage assembly. To use a man basket correctly, safely, legally with a forklift, it has to be securely attached. There are different methods for achieving that secure attachment. You can't do it like this. That's a great basket. I don't know why they're not using the forks. This setup here looks good. I do know that the Caterpillar telehandlers with this machine, the manufacturer does allow the use of a man basket with their machines. So that looks as good as it can get if you're going to do this. But it's, again, I'd still argue it's not the best practice. Another thing that you need to pay attention to if you work for a company that engages in this practice, anytime there are men in the basket, there has to be an operator in the seat. The operator can't put the men up in the air and then go off and have lunch or go and do something else. It needs to be attended at all times if there are men in the basket. Operator in the seat when men are in the basket. And there must be a means for effective communication between the operator and the men in the basket. Now, an advantage of a boom lift, the people in the basket control the boom lift. They make the boom lift go up and down. They make the boom lift travel from point A to point B. If you're in this basket, you're at the mercy of this operator. And if this operator goes and does something else and you're up in the air, well, you're stuck until the operator comes back. Also, if this operator maybe he's sick or maybe he's having a bad day, maybe he's been fighting with his wife, and he's just not clear-headed for whatever reason, and he hits the wrong lever, he can dump you to the ground. So when you're in the basket, you are at the mercy of this operator. So another reason it's not best practice to do this. When men are in the basket with this type of equipment, you should not be traveling from point A to point B. Even when you lower it, even when it's lowered as low as it will go, you should not move the machine from point A to point B with men in the basket. The men should get out before the machine is relocated. That's what happened in this accident here. Again, it's a job built basket. They were moving the machine with the basket elevated, men in the basket, and three men fell out of the basket, two died with this particular piece of equipment. Another thing about using a man basket, the only machines that are going to be approved for man basket work are going to be the machines that have the stabilizers. Now I've got this all marked up here. Let me bring my eraser back out. This has, this Caterpillar machine here has front stabilizers that can be deployed, one on each side. That makes the machine much more stable when it's elevating that basket. You should not be using a basket with machines that don't have those stabilizers. And generally speaking, if the machine doesn't have the stabilizers, the manufacturer's not going to allow it for man basket use. Again, this is just all wrong because of the job built basket. We'll talk more about this machine and the incident I've referred to here in a couple of more slides. A fourth option, which I'm really not going to spend any time on at all, if you take my crane class, I do a 40-hour crane class, nothing but cranes. I talk more about suspended personnel platforms. This is when you have a basket that's suspended from a crane. It's hoisted up in the air by the crane. The workers are hanging in the air. This is an option. It can be a productive option and a safe option. But it's only allowed by OSHA if all other options are not possible. If there's not any other way of doing it, then companies are allowed to put workers in a suspended personnel platform or in a suspended basket like this. Also, to do this correctly, there are many planning steps that have to be followed. There are certain equipment requirements that have to be met to do this correctly. You know, cranes have to be equipped with certain safety devices. The rigging that you're using to connect the basket to the hook, it has to be a certain type of rigging. There are a lot of I's to dot and T's to cross if you're going to do this. But it can be done safely. But if it's not done correctly, it can lead to loss of life. The aerial lift regulations that you do find in the OSHA construction regulations are in 1926-453, and this is a summary. There's really not a lot there. The main requirement for companies is that they comply with ANSI A92.2, that standard. ANSI stands for American National Standards Institute. It's an organization that makes recommendations about a variety of subjects. OSHA has chosen to adopt their recommendations as their regulations for aerial lift operations. So if you end up working for a company, you should become familiar with this particular ANSI standard. Some of the requirements, some additional requirements. The lift controls on your aerial lift have to be tested each day prior to use. The aerial lift should only be operated by authorized persons, and an authorized person should be trained. Operator training is crucial for the safe operation, safe use of these machines. Another regulation that you find in 1926-453, tying off to an adjacent pole or structure while in the lift, is prohibited. Which again, you may think, what's the big deal about tying off to an adjacent pole or structure? Why do they have a regulation for that? Well, there have been workers killed when they've done this. If you tie off to an adjacent structure that's outside your basket, and you forget that you're tied off to that adjacent structure and lower your basket, well, you could be left hanging there. Or there are bad things that can happen if you're tied off to an adjacent structure. Or what if it's a movable structure that you're tied off to and that structure moves? Maybe you're tied off to another piece of equipment, perhaps, and that other piece of equipment moves. We will talk more about fall protection in man lifts. It is an important concern because you're up in the air. Must always stand firmly on the floor of the basket. Feet on the floor. Feet on the deck. One of the most common mistakes you'll see from users is they'll want to step up on the mid-rail. When you step up on that mid-rail, you increase the chance of your falling out of the basket. Just one of the basic rules of safe use for aerial lifts, keep your feet on the floor. If you need to go higher, lift your basket up. If your basket won't go up any higher and you still need to go higher, then get another machine that will allow you to reach the heights that you want to go to. Harness and lanyard worn and attached to the boom of the machine or the basket. And there are exceptions to this requirement. And we'll talk about those exceptions when we talk more about fall protection specifically. Yeah, I include this picture to give you an idea of just how high you can go with some of these machines. And this would be a boom lift, and I'm guessing they're up 80 feet. Or no, probably, and this is a 135-70. I don't remember with this particular model if the 135 is probably its reach capacity, how high it can go. Not sure what the 70 would be. But so if this is a 135-foot reach machine, you know, they may be well over 100 feet up in the air. And there are boom lifts that will go even higher. And when you're up this high, or not even this high in one of these machines, and the wind's blowing, it'll get your attention. And you will be hanging on like these gentlemen are hanging on. One thing I want to mention, since I just talked about them hanging on. When you hang on to the rails, it's best not to put your hands on the outside of the rails. It's best to use the rails on the inside of the basket. The reason why you don't want to put your hands on those outside rails is so your hand doesn't get smashed against another structure. That does happen. And there are, you know, most manufacturers will have recommendations concerning keeping your hands, keeping your body, all body parts inside the basket. And that's why this particular inside rail exists. And there are multiple inside rails on this machine for people to hang on to when they're in the basket. There are 5 general types of accidents that can occur with man lifts or aerial lifts. You can have dropped objects injuring people below or causing damage to property below, falls out of the basket, tip overs, contact with overhead power lines, and then there's the potential for a collision with other equipment. And we're going to talk more about each of these as we move along. Right, let's go ahead and talk more about fall protection in man lifts. And one of the more significant hazards is falling out of the basket. One of the first steps, anytime you're using boom lift, scissor lifts, or maybe it's a telehandler with a basket, or it's a suspended personnel platform, suspended from a crane, you want to complete your work plan and a hazard analysis. And you can do a specific hazard analysis focused just on the fall protection aspects of the aerial lift work. Talk about what equipment you're going to be using, how you're going to be protected, how workers are going to be protected when they are in the baskets. But now there are some different considerations to make depending on the type of lift you're using. If it's a boom lift, you have to have some type of fall protection system in place. And when I say some type of fall protection system, I'm talking about more than just the handrail that encloses the basket. That handrail that encloses the basket, that's a first layer of fall protection, but you also have to have a personal fall arrest rig that the worker is wearing if it's in a boom lift. Boom lifts, absolutely required. But when we talk about scissor lifts, it's a little bit different. It's not required by OSHA for workers to be tied off in the basket if they're in a scissor lift. The reason for this, and there are letters of interpretation from OSHA on this issue. The reason for this, there have been multiple accidents where the worker who was in a scissor lift basket fell out of the basket, and the force produced from their fall pulled the basket over on top of them. They fall out of the basket, their weight pulls the basket over on top of them, and they are crushed by the scissor lift. Again, not a good day at work when that happens. Because of these types of incidents, OSHA does not require workers in the basket of a scissor lift to be tied off. But there are some employers, some companies, that do require workers to be tied off in the basket of a scissor lift. And the question then becomes, how do you keep the workers from falling out of the basket? If the worker doesn't fall out of the basket, they're not going to pull it over on top of them. Well, the way that we prevent the worker from falling out of the basket is by using a range-limiting device. And that range-limiting device could be as simple as a 3-foot lanyard that makes it impossible for them to fall out of the basket. It's not required by OSHA to tie off in scissor lifts because of the accidents that have occurred. But if you do need to tie off, if you work for a company that requires that, if you want to require that as a safety manager, I go both ways depending on the circumstances. There are some circumstances where I would want my workers in the scissor lift basket to be tied off, but they're going to be tied off with a range limiting system, a positioning system, not a fall arrest system. That positioning system is going to keep them from coming out of the basket. But again, something to consider when you're in this situation. Another exception to the tie-off rule: when you are working over water, the workers do not have to be tied off to the basket, but they must wear a personal flotation device, a PFD, a life jacket, a Coast Guard approved life jacket. And that's in construction and the construction regulations, that's one of the requirements. Anywhere workers are working over or near water, and there's a chance that they could fall in that water or end up in that water, and there's a risk of drowning, they have to have a personal flotation device. But back to the baskets. If you're in the basket over water, you don't have to be tied off because of an accident that occurred. And I think I mentioned this previously. There was an incident in Waco, Texas a few years back where workers were tied off. They fell into the river and they could not get free of their lanyard and ended up drowning in the river. I think it's the Trinity River that runs through Waco, or one of those Texas rivers, but they ended up drowning nonetheless because they could not disconnect their lanyard from the anchorage point. So over water, no, but you must wear the personal flotation device. Another thing, and we've already mentioned this, when you tie off, you can't tie off to an adjacent structure. It's got to be tied off in the basket. What we have here in this picture is not a good setup for a couple of main reasons. First of all, that is a job-built basket. It's not an engineered basket. Again, job-built baskets, even if a good design and it's all welded up good, should not be used. It should be an engineered basket that's been approved by someone with an engineering degree, or preferably has an engineering certification. That's going to protect the company from a liability and a legal standpoint. If you're using a job-built basket and there's an accident, then more of that liability is going to be placed on you and the company. But having it engineered, that protects the company. It's not just a safety thing, there are also legal issues involved. Another problem with this setup here: they're using a telehandler that does not have stabilizers. This telehandler, if you're going to put men in that basket, it needs stabilizers on this side and the other side that will make that machine less likely to tip over. Now, the operator is in the seat. That's good. They're doing that right. The operator, like I mentioned before, with this type of machine, always needs to be in the seat when there's men in the basket. And there needs to be good communication. Now, with this type of rig, the communication can just be yelling back and forth. If, you know, other work environments, they may not be able to yell back and forth. They may need to have radios to maintain proper communication. Like I said before, if this operator lowers the basket and wants to move to another location to set up, he needs to lower the basket. The worker should get out of the basket before moving to that other location. And the reason for this, there have been accidents, as we'll talk about, as I've already mentioned, and we'll talk more about, when workers were seriously injured or killed when they were in a basket that was moving. They fell out of the basket, the machine tips over, bad things can happen. Don't be in that basket. I mentioned range limiting devices for fall protection and man lifts. Again, positioning device is another term. Positioning device can be as simple as a 3 foot lanyard. When we do man lift activities, when we are face to face and we have man lift activities for this class or other classes, I have 3 foot lanyards that we use. And we connect those 3 foot lanyards to anchorage points inside the basket that are designated by the manufacturer. Man lifts, most man lift manufacturers will have engineered anchorage points that are identified by a label like this. They will tell you, hey, tie off here. This is where you tie off, and if the sign in the basket says tie off here, you shouldn't tie off anywhere else. You should never tie off to the top rail. You should tie off at the designated anchorage points. A lot of man lifts will have anchorage points in the deck. They will have D-rings that are recessed into the deck. That's the best tie-off point. If those D-rings in the deck with a 3 foot lanyard, there's no way the worker's falling out of the basket. There's no way he or she's climbing up over that top rail and falling out. Even if they tried, they couldn't. They'd have to disconnect their lanyard to fall out of the machine. Another issue, this is kind of an inspection point, but it's also a safety point. Man lifts will have a variety of safety signs and labels located all over the machine. These labels that came from the factory with the machine, they have to be readable. If the labels, if the safety warning labels are not legible, that machine needs to be taken out of service until those signs are replaced. Again, they all must be in place and readable, just like they were the day that machine first went into service. Another thing that you'll notice here, it has tie-off points, the anchorage points to use. It also mentions the load limit for this machine. Four persons or up to 1,000 pounds. You can't have more than four persons, or you can't have a total load that exceeds 1,000 pounds. If you have three 300 pound guys and 50 pounds of tools, you can't put another person in there. It's four persons or 1,000 pounds, whichever comes first. If you have four 125 pound guys in the basket, that's a maximum. Even that 425 pound workers, that only adds up to 500 pounds, plus say another 150 pounds for their tools. That's not 1,000 pounds, but that's still the maximum that can be placed in that basket. You will see machines with, most of the machines will have limits of 2 to 4 people. A two-person machine will be limited to 500 pounds. A three-person machine, the limit will be 750 pounds. Four-person machine, 1,000 pounds. I've never seen one that allowed more than four people or more than 1,000 pounds. And one thing to keep in mind when loading these devices, these machines, it's not just the weight of the worker. It's the weight of the worker, their tools, and any materials that they may be carrying with them in the basket. We would always run into a problem at the second company I was with. We'd put two guys in the basket, and they would each have a bucket of bolts that was used to make the connections on the girders. Well, a bucket of those bolts would weigh 150 pounds. So you put the two guys in there. Let's say they weigh 150 pounds each. That's 300 pounds. Then you have two buckets, each 150 pounds. That's another 300 pounds. That's 600 pounds, which exceeds the limit for that machine, which was 500 pounds. And one of the cool things about these machines, it's an engineering control. It's designed into the machine. If you exceed the load limit, the machine has a sensor that will detect that you've exceeded the load limit, and it's not going to go anywhere. If you put 600, 700 pounds in a 500 pound rated machine, it's not going to go up or down or move, because that sensor is shutting down the machine because it can tell that the machine is overloaded. And we would run into that in with my second company. We'd overload the machine. The workers couldn't figure out why the machine wasn't working. Well, you dumbass, you got too many bolts in there. You got to take some of that load off. You know, get down under 500 pounds, and then it'll go wherever you want it to go. Which that's a great feature. That is a great engineering control for these machines. All right, I think we've pretty much talked about fall protection in man lifts. Let's go ahead and talk a little bit about this picture. And here we have scissor lifts, and we have workers who are tied off in scissor lifts. This is actually one of my jobs from 15 years ago. We were working for a subcontractor that required us to tie off in scissor lifts. And you will run into that, and that's fine. You just make sure the workers understand that if they fall out of this basket, they can pull that thing over on top of them. And that's not the way they want to end their day, with that scissor lift on top of them. So you make sure they understand that they should not be standing on the mid rail. They should not be reaching too far over the top rail, because that's how you fall out of these baskets. You're overreaching. Even if you're tied off, if you overreach and fall out, this thing could come over on top of you. Now, they are not using short lanyards. I should have had them in the 3-foot positioning lanyards, but they are using full 6-foot shock absorbing lanyards. Again, my safety meeting every morning on this job: don't fall out of the baskets. Don't fall out of the baskets, and you'll be in good shape. But if it was my job, I wouldn't require them to tie off in the scissor lift in this particular work environment. But I would still be having that safety meeting. That I would still be encouraging them: don't fall out of the basket. And falling out of the basket is not good for anybody at any time. So let's avoid that. Keep your feet on the deck. Again, if you fall out of one of these things, you're tied off to it, you can pull it over on top of you. And we're going to see some pictures of scissor lifts tipped over before we're done here. Some additional points when it comes to man lift usage. Got to be aware of power lines. This should be addressed in your hazard analysis. Are there power lines in the area? How are we going to stay out of the power lines? At least 10 feet clearance from power lines. If your machine has stabilizers, those stabilizers should be used. They're there for a reason. They're there to make the machine more stable, to prevent tip overs. Make sure the ground that you're working on is firm and level. If the ground is soft, that can cause a tip over. Also, be aware of any edges or drop-offs in the work environment. Believe that's what happened in the Waco accident when the guys fell in the river. They were working on a ledge. They ended up driving their machine off that ledge and falling into the river. So that could have been prevented with stop blocks or some concrete barrier wall. But that wasn't in place, and the men died when they were tied off to the basket and drowned. Pay attention to the weather, the wind and the lightning, especially if you're in a boom lift, 135 feet up in the air. You don't want to be up in the air when it's windy or when there's lightning in the area. Many companies have policies requiring jobs to shut down when there's lightning in the area. Not just the shutdown of work in man lifts, but all work shuts down when there's lightning within 6 miles. That was the policy at one of my former companies. The lightning within 6 miles, you shut everything down until the lightning moves out of the area. Do not overload. We've talked about that a little bit. You don't want to put more weight in it than it's rated for. It can cause a collapse. The equipment needs to be inspected daily in the morning before each use. All of the controls need to be tested. You need to walk around and look at at look for leaks, look for anything that doesn't look right. If something doesn't look right, if you think it might be affecting the safety of the machine, then have a mechanic come out and take a look at it. Don't take a chance with a machine that's going to have you 50, 60, 100 feet up in the air. Follow all of the manufacturer limitations. When I train operators on different types of lifts, I go through the manufacturer limitations. I say, guys, the manufacturer says you can't do this, so don't do it. Those manufacturer limitations are there for a reason. They're there to protect you. They're to protect the manufacturer also. But mostly it's about you. We don't want anybody hurt in these machines. That's what the limitations are there for. Another issue, and if this were a face-to-face class, I'd ask you if there's anything else going on in this picture that looks kind of sketchy. And usually I'll have at least one student say, why do they have their booms crossed? Not a good thing to have your booms crossed. You don't want to cross your booms with a boom lift, because a boom under tension can collapse if it is bumped by another object. Just a slightest bump, if there's weight on that boom, like we have weight here on this boom, and we have weight here on this boom. If this boom raises up into that boom, just a slight tap, that can cause this boom to collapse. It could cause both booms to collapse. Now, if they're not loaded, the risk isn't quite as great. But that loaded basket creates tension that makes the boom more susceptible to collapse when there's some type of external contact. So don't cross the booms. There's no OSHA rule about this. There's no, I don't even think there's an ANSI rule or any rule that anything in the books that say don't cross the booms. But if you cross the booms and they bump into each other, collapses can occur. I've used this picture a couple of times already, and I've referred to this accident and a couple of accidents already related to this type of machine. There was an accident a few years back in Edmond, Oklahoma, where there were three workers in a basket just like this. The basket was elevated. The operator tries to move the machine and the basket from point A to point B while the basket's still up in the air. They hit a bump. All three workers were thrown out of the basket. Two of them died. Now, that's not because this was a job-built basket. That was because the basket should have been lowered. You know, they shouldn't be using a job-built basket, but more importantly, the basket should have been lowered. The men should have got out. The workers should have got out before they went, before the machine was moved. Let me go ahead and pull this article up. I do have an article here, if I can get it to work. Bear with me just, there we go. Wasn't wanting to work. Two workers dead, one injured after lift accident in Edmond, September 19th, 2014. Two workers have died and another worker is injured after an industrial accident Friday afternoon in Edmond. Daniel Burney, 54, and his brother Michael Burney, 56, died. A 21-year-old suffered injuries also. Let's see. The three workers were working on the second floor of an apartment complex when it tipped over. Officials say the three workers were all on the platform of the lift when it fell. Again, this doesn't tell the whole story. The whole story was they were moving. The operator was moving the lift with the basket elevated. And they hit, I don't remember if it was a bump or some, you know, an object that was on the ground. That caused the machine to tip over. And that's what we need to avoid. That's what we want to avoid. That's what we want our workers to avoid when we're working as safety professionals. But I'll make a bold prediction here. Some of you will deal with fatalities in your career. Not an engineered basket. The stabilizers are good, though. I do like the fact they're using stabilizers with the basket. They just need a better basket. From a legal standpoint, from a safety standpoint, they need a real engineered basket. There was another incident where three workers were severely injured when the operator attempted to move machine with an elevated basket. Now, this is different than the Edmund accident. We have two different incidents, almost exactly the same circumstances. And you'll run into this as a safety manager. You'll have workers who think, well, why can't we do this? I've done it before. It seems safe to me. We'll be careful. We'll take precautions. Why can't we do this? And just because you can do it doesn't mean it's safe, doesn't mean you should do it. You know, take the extra precautions. If these companies had taken the extra precautions, they wouldn't have been going to a coworker's funeral. If you don't go the extra mile, I'm always talking about dotting your I's and crossing your T's. That means you got to be perfect when it comes to this stuff. You don't want to take any risks when it comes to people's lives. And when you're using this kind of basket, or when you're taking chances with the machine, you're running the risk of someone losing their life. We'll talk about these scissor lift accidents here in a second, but some additional man lift points. Collision hazards, not just boom collisions, but collisions between different machines. If you have a scissor lift set up in an area where forklifts are operating, you want to cordon off that area. You don't want a forklift bumping into your scissor lift or your boom lift or whatever kind of lift you're using. In falling objects, you should have a dropped objects or a falling objects prevention plan in place. And that can take a lot of different forms. You know, that's another 30-minute discussion right there, just talking about a dropped objects prevention plan. And we talked about that a little bit earlier in the semester. Something to watch out for with your operators, and this is something you want to include in your training. They should not be climbing over the top rail to get out of the lift onto, say, a roof, or they shouldn't be climbing from a roof over the top rail into the basket. That force, that climbing into, climbing out of, can be enough to tip over, especially scissor lifts. You're climbing out of the basket onto a roof. As you're climbing out, you're pushing against the scissor lift, and it doesn't take much for these things to go over, especially when they're fully extended like this. Now, this one does have the outriggers, making it a little more stable. But when you're climbing out, you're putting force against that scissor lift, it can cause it to tip over. Should not be used as a crane for material handling. If you need to move a bundle of lumber up onto the second floor of a building that's under construction, get a crane, get a forklift. Man lifts aren't designed for material handling. Man lifts, aerial lifts, are only used for people. Keep your body extremities in the basket. Keep your hands on the inside rails, not on the outside rails. The reason you want, and I mentioned this before, but it's worth mentioning again. If you have your hands or other body parts outside the basket, there's a chance for those body parts to be crushed. Let's say your basket is up against a building, and you get too close, and your buddy's arm is on the outside of the basket, and you're operating it, and you end up crushing your buddy's arm between the basket and the building that you're up against. Keep everything inside the basket. And operators have to be trained. They have to be qualified. They have to be approved by the company. One of the most common mistakes you'll see with smaller companies, they will put anybody that can breathe in one of these machines without any training. They'll throw you the keys and say, figure it out. That's not a good safety plan. You know, figure it out is figure it out is never a good safety plan. You got to make sure the operators know what they're doing. They have some training. If you don't take that basic precaution, then you're running a, you're risking the lives of workers and also the life of your company. If your company has a fatality accident, that could be the end of your company. But let's look at a couple of these accidents. This was 2020 in Oklahoma City. Officials say one person is dead following an accident in Oklahoma City. Initial reports indicated that two people were trapped after a scissor lift tipped over inside a nearby building. They were trapped underneath the scissor lift. Once emergency crews arrived on the scene, they realized that one person was dead and another was seriously injured after the scissor lift fell while approximately 40 feet in the air. And don't remember if this says they were tied off or not. They were probably tied off, fell out, thing fell on top of them. But yeah, just to illustrate how easily these things tip over, here's another scissor lift tip over from 2020 in Maine. Workplace accident in which a scissor lift he was using tipped over at a job site. Accident killed James Thompson of Yarmouth. Thompson was painting the inside of a garage from a 12-foot scissor lift when a garage door opened, hit the lift's cage, and that garage door hitting the lift's cage tipped it over. That goes back to what we're talking about with collisions and making sure the area is secure. You don't want a garage door or another machine bumping into your scissor lift or your boom lift. And they do very easily tip over. Just keep that in mind if you're working for a company that uses these machines. Probably the greatest hazard with scissor lifts is tip over. Also, power lines. I'm taking a lot of time here, but horrible accident a couple years ago in Fayetteville, Arkansas with a scissor lift. Two workers in the basket right underneath the power lines. I don't know what they were thinking. They raised that scissor lift right up into the power lines, electrocuted both of them. You got to be aware of power lines at all times when you're up in the air. And we're almost done. Just a couple of more pictures to talk about. What I was talking about earlier, keeping your feet on the deck. You got to tie off and keep your feet on the floor. He could have easily raised up the basket to reach a little bit higher, but instead he's standing on the mid-rail. And when he's standing on that mid-rail, he's running the risk of falling over that top rail. This was the second company I was at within the first 6 months. Still had a lot of work to do with this company. A lot of improvements that needed to be made. And we have four men in a basket here. Is it overloaded? It could be overloaded. Most boom lifts are not rated for four workers. Some are, but most aren't. I'm guessing, again, this is not one of my jobs. This previous one here, this wasn't one of my jobs, but it was a company I worked for. This one is not. So I don't know exactly the rating on this machine, but I'm guessing it's not four people. I'm guessing it's overloaded. I'm guessing that because I've seen multiple times where, well, they'll put as many people in the basket as they can get in the basket. They don't think about the warning label. That's why we got to train them. That's why we got to work with them. That's why we have to encourage them and coach them so that they are aware and they do pay attention to those things. Good guys, great guys, they don't want to get hurt. They're not bad people because they don't pay attention to a warning sign. And if we train them to pay attention to warning signs, then they will. Or that's been my experience, at least. So, all right, well, that brings us to the end of our aerial lift discussion and also an end to Unit 8 where we've talked about scaffolds and aerial lifts. Let me know if you have any questions.